In 1972, Congress passed the Clean Water Act, in which farms with specific characteristics such as size, housing style, or location were identified as potential pollutants to the farm's nearby water sources. This law was the beginning of the NPDES, or National Pollution Discharge Elimination System, which was created to regulate the discharge of liquid waste. The program is run and regulated by the Environmental Protection Agency, or the EPA. When referring to liquid waste, we are referring to a mixture of feces, urine, and water that collects at a farm with livestock. The water could be from rain or from cleaning processes that take place on the farm. It was in the Clean Water Act of 1972, under a section of general definitions, that the term concentrated animal feeding operation was first used. 4 years later, in 1976, the EPA created the first specific definition for a concentrated animal feeding operation, or CAFO for short. 28 years later, after seeing many increases and changes to farm sizes and production methods, the definitions and regulations for CAFOs were revised. The goals of the EPA in regards to defining CAFOs, requiring permits, and monitoring the discharge of waste from farms is to avoid pollution of any kind and to help farmers reduce greenhouse gas emissions. To summarize, CAFO is a definition that is used for regulatory means by the EPA. Now that you have a little bit of background on the origin of the acronym CAFO, let's dig a little deeper. What kind of farm is considered a CAFO? Are all farms CAFOs? To be able to answer this question, you first need to start by defining an animal feeding operation, abbreviated as AFO and pronounced as AFO. The U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, or EPA, defines AFOs as agricultural enterprises where animals are kept and raised in confined situations. Animal feeding operations are farms where animals are kept in a set space. They could be enclosed in a corral or a pasture, somehow with fences. In addition, feed is brought to the animals. The animals do not obtain their own feed by grazing within their living space. This means that the animal's feed is grown in a field somewhere other than where the animal is housed. For example, alfalfa hay. Feed is then harvested. In the case of alfalfa, it is dried and then stored in bales. The feed is then transported and fed to livestock. I used the example of hay, but I could have also used many other examples such as corn, soybeans, and other grains that are commonly fed to livestock. Now let's look at what a concentrated animal feeding operation is. CAFO is an EPA term for a large concentrated animal feeding operation. Note that this acronym could be pronounced CAFO or CAFO. It generally varies by region, but both pronunciations are referring to a concentrated animal feeding operation. To be considered a CAFO, animals need to be confined for more than 45 days during the year. It doesn't have to be consecutive days, just total days within a 12-month period. Animals are fed harvested feed that was grown in a separate location to where the animals are housed. It could be forages like hay or various grains, depending on the species of livestock. Another key point to defining a farm as a CAFO is that it needs to have more than 1,000 animal units. An animal unit is defined as an animal equivalent of 1,000 pounds of live weight. This is distinguished because 1,000 broiler chickens, for example, is not going to produce as much waste as 1,000 head of cattle. So if we look at a few species, if we're looking at dairy cows, we can have 700 dairy cows to equal 1,000 animal units. Because beef cows tend to be a little smaller than dairy cows, we can have 1,000 beef cows. 2,500 pigs that are over 55 pounds. 125,000 broiler chickens. 10,000 sheep. And 82,000 layer hens. So note that any farms that have more animals than these are going to be considered a CAFO. I'll add one more distinction. These numbers for each species represent large CAFOs. In some circumstances, a farm can be designated as a significant contributor of pollutants. In this case, smaller farms can also be considered CAFOs. This would be considered on a case-by-case basis and would be called a small or a medium CAFO. Remember that the purpose of identifying a farm as a CAFO is to monitor and regulate how potential pollutants are handled so that they do not damage natural resources, particularly our water resources. In all cases, large farms are considered CAFOs and monitored. Small and medium farms are classified and monitored when needed. In summary, the conditions of an animal feeding operation are not likely to contaminate or pollute waterways. They are not monitored by the EPA and only need to follow the zoning regulations of their city or county. In contrast, CAFOs, or concentrated animal feeding operations, do need to follow specific parameters for waste management and other general practices to avoid damaging natural resources such as water. Permits are required and monitoring takes place on farms classified as CAFOs. Let's look at a few examples. The first one I'm going to start with is a hobby farm. This is not a commercial farm where the owner is likely to earn their income, but it is a farm that's common across the United States. So for example, let's say we have 3 horses, 2 steers, and 15 hens. These animals are housed in corrals in the winter and pastured in the summer. They're fed harvested hay and grain in the winter and graze in the summer. Would this farm be considered a concentrated animal feeding operation or an animal feeding operation? Due to size and the fact that the animals are fed harvested hay and grain, this farm would be considered an animal feeding operation or AFO. Okay, how about an egg farm with 97,000 laying hens? This particular farm is a cage-free aviary system, and just like all poultry, they are fed harvested grains as their feed. This egg farm is considered a CAFO. You may have wondered if a cage-free housing style impacted whether or not this farm was classified as a CAFO. Remember that the number of animals and how they are fed are the determining factors. CAFOs can be many different housing styles. Let's look at a sheep farm. This particular farm has 5,000 ewes. They're housed mostly on the range, where they graze and eat forage on rangelands all year. The only time they're not on rangelands is for about 8 weeks in the spring when they're lambing. This would be an animal feeding operation. How about a beef ranch with 800 mother cows? These cows are mostly housed on the range. They forage on rangelands in the warm months. And then in the winter time, they eat harvested feed because they live in a climate with a lot of snowy weather. Would this be a CAFO or an animal feeding operation? Since we have less than 1,000 cattle in this beef ranch, this would be considered an animal feeding operation. Let's look at a pig farm and say that we have 5,000 sows or mother pigs that are housed in indoor barns that are climate controlled and fed harvested grains. Pigs eat primarily corn and soybeans. This farm would be considered a concentrated animal feeding operation. The last farm we'll look at is a dairy farm. Let's say that this farm has 1,000 milk cows. They're housed in freestall barns and dry lot corrals, and they're fed harvested forages and grains and other byproducts. This farm would be classified as a CAFO. Now that you know what a CAFO is, let's weigh out the benefits and challenges of livestock farms that are classified this way. On the benefit side, CAFOs efficiently produce large amounts of meat, dairy, and poultry products. This efficiency, along with economic principles like economies of scale, lowers the cost of food. These farms also contribute to the economy by generating jobs and revenue. Looking at the challenges, there are environmental concerns due to the volume of animal waste that comes from a farm where a large amount of animals are housed in a relatively small space. CAFOs also raise animal welfare concerns associated with livestock being confined in smaller spaces. Given the challenges that are associated with confined animal feeding operations, you might ask yourself, what would it take to transition away from CAFO livestock systems? Climate and weather determines a land's ability to feed livestock. In order for livestock to be fed harvested feeds for less than 45 days per year, the area where the animals are housed has to have a climate where plant growth is supported nearly year-round. These climate conditions do exist, but they are limited. The shift to livestock farming with the use of CAFOs has been due to its efficiency and the benefits of economies of scale. Moving away will likely decrease efficiency, leading to higher production costs for farmers and higher food costs for consumers. Access to sufficient land for pasture-based farming can be limited, especially in densely populated or urban areas. Balancing the value of increased food production with the challenges of environmental sustainability and animal welfare remains a critical issue in the ongoing debate surrounding CAFOs. Technological advancements and sustainable farming practices are essential for ensuring the long-term viability of food production systems while safeguarding the environment and animal welfare.